The next matter to come before the court this morning is the State of Ohio versus Malik Rimberg. Each party will have 15 minutes in which to present their case. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you're the appellant and you wish to reserve that time, please let me know when you come up to the podium. I'm keeping track of the clock and will keep your prize in the passage of time. We are being visually and audibly recorded to be posted online, so please try to remain behind this front podium as much as possible. We have read your briefs and are ready to proceed when you are.
I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you,
Your Honor. May it please the court, my name is Stephen Hannadell. I represent the appellant, Malik Rimberg. It's a very narrow issue in this case that being presented for appeal, and a very short brief, and it's a very short issue. This comes down to the state's lack of sufficient evidence to support serious physical harm to property. And in this case, Mr. Rembert led the police on a high-speed chase, and eventually it resulted in a pit maneuver by the officer and resulted in a collision between Mr. Rembert's vehicle and the officer's vehicle. And so, he was charged accordingly with multiple offenses, and one of the offenses that he was charged with was but the critical component to make it a felony was the serious physical harm to property. So when looking at the state's case in chief, it was a trial of the bench, and all they had was just the officer's testimony saying that, it was out for about a month. He was able to drive the vehicle that night of the crash. The damage was, according to the officer's testimony, was a broken push bar and damage to the front bumper, headlight assembly, and fender. So the push bar is there to make sure that it's to prevent damage to the rest of the vehicle, more serious damage to the rest of the vehicle. That's what the bar is there for, is protection. So there was damage to that. It took the brunt of the force and knocked out a headlight and then damaged the front bumper and fender. The vehicle was still drivable that night. It needed repair, but there was no documentation presented by the state as to what exact repairs were done and therefore detailing as to the nature, how serious was the damage to the vehicle.
Did the dash cam video show any of the damage? I'm sorry.
No, you go right ahead.
There was dash camera video of the chase and of the crash. I don't recall from the dash camera video as far as showing all the exact damage. It was at night, so you're talking about lighting limited. So it probably would have been more helpful if, let's say, they would have had pictures from the body shop in better lighting conditions to show the damage to the vehicle and documentation to say, okay, we had to replace this, and because this little part was damaged, that meant we had to get underneath and replace another bigger part. There wasn't any conversation about that.
Was there any dispute that the car was taken out of service for repairs? Is there any dispute that the car was taken out of service for repairs?
No dispute on that, as far as per the officer's testimony.
Counsel.
The exact quote from
You keep saying the officer's testimony. Isn't that evidence?
It is, but I don't think it's sufficient in this case.
And do you have any case law that says they need more? I mean, doesn't that go to credibility?
As far as this particular issue we're dealing with, I could not find any case law in regards to serious physical harm to property. So this is sort of a case of first impression, I think, for the court and for all of us. The officer's testimony, the way it was presented in the court, the prosecutor has gave a suggested question to the officer as to, was it out of commission for about a month? And you used the word about. And then the officer said, I think so.
Well, would it matter if it was a week, a month, a day?
I think it's a factor.
How much time does it have to be out of commission?
I think time's a factor in the analysis. Because I don't think there's no set time that says, okay, well, if it's without this long, then we know it's serious. For all we know, the repair shop could have had a backlog of repairs to do, and then it could have sat there. It could have been some routine repair that could have been done in short order, and maybe there was a backlog as to the repairs. We don't know. That evidence wasn't presented in terms of the documentation. And so in the statute, 2921.331C5.1, it says serious physical harm. Well, I'm sorry, that's the statute for the offense. Serious physical harm to property is defined 2901.01A6. as resulting in a substantial loss of value, which there's no evidence presented of that, or requires substantial amount of time, effort, or money to repair or replace, or temporarily prevents the use or enjoyment of the property or substantially interferes with the use or enjoyment for an extended period of time. So the statute uses extended period of time. There's no bright line as to what is extended period of time, and there's no bright line as to when they say the word substantial amount of time, effort, or money to repair or replace. Well, there was no evidence presented as to what money and what time was put into to repair or replace. There's no documentation from the body shop as to what they exactly had to do with it. And, you know, could, for all we know, there could have been a reason unrelated to the damage as to why it was out for about a month.
Well, it still would have been out, regardless of why, right?
Per the officer's testimony, and again, and like I said, I caution that because the way that was presented, the prosecutor gave a suggesting question, and the officer said, I think so. So it wasn't even really definite on the officer's part. It wasn't even necessarily a firm.
It's suggested by opposing counsel here in the brief that is not exactly how it was presented. That's how it was presented the second time, but that the officer, in fact, testified on his own initially that it was out for a month.
As far as with my reading of the transcript, I mean, I could be wrong.
I haven't read it, so.
I don't ever claim to, always be right or to always... never be mistake-free, but from my recollection from reading the transcript and when I wrote the brief and laid out the facts, it as far as the time frame when the word month was used, that's when that came from the prosecutor's mouth, and then the officer just said, I think so. So, and there wasn't really any other proof presented to present any sort of exactness. It's just way too inexact.
Well, is there any dispute as to whether the vehicle was damaged at all?
No.
Okay. Is there any dispute that damage would have to be repaired?
No.
And then it would require some time to repair it. And the vehicle would be out of commission while it was being repaired.
Understood.
Okay.
But I think the statute requires more exactness in terms of, if we're going to call it serious physical harm, I mean, we definitely got physical harm to property. There's no question. The question is, do we have serious physical harm to property?
There's no case law out there that says what serious physical harm is.
There's not. It's very slim pickings, from what I recall from my research, and I usually do go through.
An office chair full of baby powder, would it be?
What's that?
An office chair full of baby powder that needs to be replaced?
Yeah.
There's case law out there about that.
All I know is that I couldn't find much case law on this particular topic as far as serious physical harm to property and what that means, and because I don't think it's been litigated very much. And so so perhaps this court can help clear that up one way or the other. But from the way I see it, I think the prosecutor could have presented more evidence to back their claim, and they just chose not to. And I don't think it was that much to ask of them to present testimony from a body shop repairman, documentation, and say, this is what all we had to do, this was the value of the work that had to be done, this was the likely value of the damage to the property, and it had to be out for a month because of X, Y, and Z damage to the vehicle. None of that was presented. It was just the officer saying, well, I think so. And so I just think that we need to demand stronger evidence than that from the state, that if they're going to prove all the elements to a felony, we're not asking that much more of them to present that proof. And I just think it just comes down to just taking shortcuts. And I think, I think the court needs to tell the state to say, hey, if you're going to prove a felony, make sure you present all your proof, to each and every element of the offense. And I don't think they presented any sufficient evidence of serious physical harm. There's no question there's physical harm, but not serious. And that makes a difference between felony and a misdemeanor in this particular offense. So if there's no more questions, I will reserve the remainder of my time for rebuttal.
Thank you. Yep.
Thank
you. 6 minutes.
Thank you, Your Honors. May it please the court, Lindsay Poprocki on behalf of Appellee, the State of Ohio. Malik Rumbert asserts a single assignment of error based on the insufficiency of the evidence. Rundberg claims that the state failed to sufficiently prove that he proximately caused serious physical harm to Sergeant Matthewson's cruiser for purposes of his felony three failure to comply conviction. As the court is aware, sufficiency of the evidence produced by the state is in essence a test of adequacy. In reviewing a conviction on the sufficiency standard, the relevant inquiry is whether the state, after viewing the evidence in the light most favorable to the prosecution, any rational trier of fact could find the elements of the offense proven beyond a reasonable doubt. In count one of Rupert's indictment, he was charged with failure to comply with order or signal of a police officer in violation of RC 2921.331B, a felony of the third degree. Under that statute, no person shall operate a motor vehicle so as to willfully elude or flee a police officer after receiving a visible or audible signal from a police officer to stop. The felony rises to a third degree felony if operation of the motor vehicle was a proximate cause of serious physical harm to persons or property. And Rundberg was indicted under that section. Importantly, serious physical harm to property is defined under RC 2901.01E6 and occurs when property requires a substantial amount of time, effort, or money to repair or replace, or when property is temporarily prevented from use or enjoyment. In denying Rupert's criminal 29 motion as to count one, the trial court relied on Matthewson's testimony as the damage sustained by his police cruiser. The court specifically relied on Matthewson's testimony that the push bar was broken, the front bumper was damaged, that the passenger side headlight and fender were damaged, and that it took approximately 1 month to repair the vehicle.
The testimony that you're referring to, in your brief, it says, in court, he stated the damage suffered from the maneuver, you can see in the video.
Correct.
Is there a video that shows the damage to the vehicle?
There was a dash cam video from Sergeant Matthewson's vehicle.
Does it show the damage to the front of his vehicle?
That, to me, is unclear whether it would have shown the damage to his vehicle. It definitely showed the chase, but whether you could have seen the damage. That was his testimony, though. You can see the damage.
But more importantly, is that part of the record as well?
Yes.
The video? Okay, so we can look at that.
Yes, you can. And I would point out that at the transcript at page 89 is the testimony of Sergeant Matthewson, where he testifies as to his own volition that it took approximately 1 month for the repair to be done to his vehicle, and that it was a follow-up question by the prosecutor where he says, I think so, as to whether the vehicle was in the shop for a month. So I would kind of take issue with whether the testimony as to whether the car was in the shop for a month was simply persuaded by the prosecutor.
Of course, counsel says it could have been 1 day to make those repairs, and it could have been sitting there ready to go after a day, which would not really fit a substantial amount of time to repair or extended period of time that it had to be out of service.
But serious physical harm pursuant to the statute also means that the property is temporarily prevented from use or enjoyment pursuant to the statute. And the way I read the statute is that it's an either or standard that's in the alternative. So that would fit under that provision of the statute as well. And part of his counsel's argument is also that Matthewson's testimony alone was insufficient to prove the element of serious physical harm. And he asserts that documentation, such as repair costs or receipts, are also necessary to support Matthewson's testimony. But he's failed to cite any legal authority or case citations to support his argument. As I said, the requirements for establishing serious physical harm are statutory. The statute provides that serious physical harm to property occurs when either a substantial amount of time is required to repair the property or the physical harm temporarily prevents the use of the property. Here the state met both statutory criteria to establish that Matthewson's police cruiser suffered serious physical harm. for repair for approximately a month, and during such time he was prevented from using his vehicle. Overall, Rumbert led several officers on a high-speed chase that lasted several minutes. He had many chances to stop during the chase, but failed to do so. He did not fail the traffic. He failed to follow the traffic control signs while all officers were using their lights and sirens. The pit maneuver that Mathewson initiated was necessitated by Rumbert's actions, and the serious physical damage sustained to Mathewson's cruiser was a consequence flowing from Rumbert's failure to comply. And I would also take issue with counsel's suggestion that serious physical harm has not been defined in other cases throughout the state. Specifically, the state cites to State v. Great House. We've cited several of these cases in our brief. In Great House, similar to here, the defendant did not stop for police, drove down an access road, stopped his vehicle, and then testified that he mistakenly placed his vehicle in reverse instead of park and fled the vehicle. The truck reversed and struck a police cruiser behind it, and the court there noted that there was serious physical harm to the police cruiser, and the fact that the defendant testified that it was a mistake to place his vehicle in reverse was of no consequence. Rather, the penalty enhancement provision for the felony three, that was simply contingent upon a factual finding that the defendant had willfully evaded or fled the police. If the trier of fact found that the serious physical harm resulted, then the defendant's conduct was enhanced to the felony. There are other cases cited by the state, State v. Payne, I believe, and State v. Stevenson. And here we would just submit the evidence viewed in the light most favorable to the state was sufficient to prove that Rumbert approximately caused serious physical harm to the property, and we would ask that the court, this honorable court, affirm the decision of the trial court. Questions?
Thank you. We have 6 minutes.
I'd like to tell you what I'm interested in.
Go ahead.
The issue of temporarily prevented from using the vehicle.
Okay.
It would appear that this case fits that definition. Can you address that for me?
Well, the way I'm reading the statute, I think the phrase extended period of time at the end of the statute applies, and because if you read it, temporarily prevents the use of enjoyment of the property or substantially interferes with the use of enjoyment, and then it says for an extended period of time. So my reading of the statute, that the phrase for an extended period of time applies to both parts, so the temporarily prevents the use of enjoyment of the property has to be for an extended period of time.
How does that or make it apply to both parts?
What's that?
How does that or make it apply to both parts? It's what happens when you have an English major up here. Sorry.
I'm just reading the statute's totality, and I don't know if this might be one of those kind of phrases that Justice French of the Supreme Court, I know she's an English guru.
We're dangerous.
that she would get involved in. But... I know I've seen Supreme Court decisions over the placement of a comma and things like that, but the way I, at least what I'm reading it, it seems to me that it temporarily prevents the use for enjoyment or substantially interferes with the use of enjoyment. So it's talking about use for enjoyment, and then so on the one hand it's saying temporarily prevents, and then it's saying substantially interferes, and then it says for extended period of time. So I suppose reasonable minds can disagree on how that can be read, but the only other thing I would add is that there's no question that the officer's testimony is probative, but when he says about a month, and I think so, I mean it's really showing the inexactness of their memory. I mean, human memory does not operate like a tape recorder, and it's often very exact, often subject to influence and subject to forgetfulness and sometimes you think you saw something, but it really wasn't. And that's why we write things down. That's why we keep a court record. That's why we keep maintenance records and repair records and, you know, billing records and so on and so forth, because we forget things.
Even if it was half off, it was only 2 weeks. Is that substantial?
I think it depends on the nature of the repairs. It's because we have to answer, well, why? What was the reason for it not being 2 weeks? Was it because of the backlog of in the body shop, and therefore had to sit there until the repairman could get to it? Or, you know, maybe they could have taken it to a different body shop and could have gotten repaired right away. I think those questions just have to be answered.
And arguably, doesn't that go back to causation, though? He's not just responsible for the immediate, I mean.
Well, I suppose you get to, like, proximate cause, although I don't know how much of, like, the civil negligence standard would apply to this, but I would think that if we're going to pin this on my client in terms of a felony, I think there has to be a direct proximate cause all the way through. Especially because we're going with the statutory definition. We're not going with common law definition. We're going with what's in the statute in 2901 and as to how the statute defines these things. So all I'm saying in general is that it's not that much to require the state just to present a little bit more documentation, just some harder evidence, just to show what exactly was the damage and why it was out and so on and so forth. And if they could have done that, I don't think I'd be able to raise this issue. So I think that's all I have.
You probably answered this, but just so it's clear in my mind, do you have any case law that supports your interpretation of the statute as far as
I could not find any. Like I said, there was not much. This particular statute, I don't think it's been litigated very much at all, and so I think there is going to be some trailblazing by this court in this regard.
I thought that was going to be your answer, but I wanted to make sure.
I don't have anything else.
All right. Thank you for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which will be mailed to both sides as well as posted to our website, and that is Supreme Court.